Welcome back to this special series as part of Walk Thru Voices that we call Nativity. I hope these short little talks are helping you really focus on what matters most during this Christmas season. We've been looking at different characters, and today we're going to focus in on Mary. And depending on your church background, you might have been raised in a tradition to adore Mary. Some get uncomfortable with that, and so it's easy for the pendulum to swing so far that we actually ignore Mary, and the story's not about her, it's about Jesus. But if we read the scriptures with open minds, what we see is Mary is very worthy of respect, of honor. And there's a lot she can teach us if we're just willing to learn from her and then take the next step and actually imitate her. We meet Mary for the first time in the Christmas story in Luke chapter 1, verse 26. The Bible says, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, that's a relative of Mary, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." I don't know how they planned weddings back then, but I'm guessing Mary had probably subscribed Joseph to Galilee Groom, and she's reading Bethlehem Bride, and she's preparing for this day. The synagogue has been, it's been reserved, and they've lined up the best sketch artists to capture their special day and pictures. Their weddings have always been a big deal throughout history. And Mary, we learn later, she seems to be a planner. And so she's probably thinking a lot about the big day that's coming up. And suddenly, an angel interrupts everything. And he comes and he greets her. And her response is much like most people in Scripture. When they meet an angel, they're terrified. The angel says, as most angels do, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you not a message of judgment. I'm bringing you good news." Says, "You're going to give birth to a son, and you're going to call his name Jesus. He will be great, be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary is told by the angel, "You're already pregnant. You're expecting." Her response is the only logical question any of us would have. "How is this possible? Since I'm a virgin, I know the facts of life. I know where babies come from. And Joseph and I have stayed pure. There's no possible way that I'm pregnant." The angel goes on and he explains, "Well, actually, the Holy Spirit has conceived inside of you a miracle child, the promised Messiah, Jesus Christ." He answers her question, but he doesn't give her the details. He doesn't explain the science behind it, so much so that centuries later, we still marvel and we ask questions, how exactly was this virgin birth possible? But our takeaway today is really in verse 38. After hearing all this, still no doubt full of lots of questions, Mary simply answered, "May your word to me be fulfilled." And then the angel left her. She's still full of questions. She's got to have fears. How's Joseph going to respond? What are our families going to say about this? Will I be cast out of the village? Will anyone believe what it is that I've experienced? And yet she says, "What you will for me, I'm in. I'm all in." The big lesson for us, I think, for Mary's life is this, that Mary's dreams had to die in order for God's dream to be born through her. Her dreams of that big synagogue wedding, that the dream of family coming together in joy and everybody going, "Yes, we have no doubts about this relationship. This is right." All of that, as well as future career plans for her new husband, everything is thrown into question by this short conversation with an angel. And yet Mary says, "What you will, I'm good with it. Let's go." You know, this is where Mary, I think, inspires all of us, because we all have dreams for our lives. Even this Christmas season, some of our dreams aren't being fulfilled. We aren't together with all of our relatives like we normally might be. Even in our family, I mean, I always wanted to have a big family. So did Ellen. Our two children are precious, but only one of them can be with us this year. Philip and his family are in the midst of moving and COVID concerns. Extended family, all I had was one brother, one sister. My sister died on my 50th birthday and went on to glory. My mom and dad have both been ahead of us. We're a very small family, and even our whole family can't be together. Sometimes, though, our dreams have to die, and we're waiting to see what special thing is God going to do. Career frustrations, disappointments, a relationship that was so precious to you ended, and you didn't want it to end. We could go on and on. We imagine if we follow Christ, we won't struggle health-wise. And yet right now, you're struggling with a really tough illness. Sometimes our dreams have to die for God's dream to be born in us and through us. Be encouraged by the example of Mary, regardless of your background and how you were raised to view her. She is worthy of honor. Learn from her. Imitate her as you celebrate the climax of the story, which comes in our talk next week when we focus on Jesus himself. But sometimes our dreams, like Mary's, have to die for God's dream to be born in us and through us. We'll see you next week. Thank you.